Hi everyone and welcome again to my channel. For this video, I will cover another mini PC, just like I did in the last video. This time I have an HP ProDesk 600G2 and during this video I will do a complete disassembly and reassembly, and while doing so I will also upgrade the storage using this NVMe SSD drive and increase the memory. Once everything is completed, and if the machine still works of course, I will also perform some benchmarks to see how well this small PC performs. Just like in other videos I did on mini PCs, this one is very similar and it allows you to have a very reasonable performance in a very small form factor. This makes it very easy to hide somewhere in a closet or even just behind your monitor if you would like that. Obviously, you won't be able to do things like installing a dedicated GPU in here, but despite its small size, it's still pretty expandable as you will see further in the video. This model specifically is part of HP's ProDesk 600G2 series and came on the market somewhere end of 2015. Also, connectivity wise, there is little to complain about. On the front side, we have the power button, two USB 3 Type A ports, USB-C, and two audio ports. On the back side, we can see a display port, VGA, additional display port, more USB ports, Ethernet, and a connector for the power supply. That power supply is external, but fortunately HP chose to use the same standard as is available for their laptops, as you can see. In my case, the unit came with a 90 watt power supply, but I've also read in the manual that 65 watts should be enough. Let's take a look inside now. To do so, we can just loosen the single thumb screw which is on the back and then move the cover forwards to remove it. Inside we can see a 2.5-inch SSD and multiple M.2 slots are underneath. The CPU heatsink covering the CPU and a fan which we can easily lift to reveal the two memory slots where one module is currently installed. Let's start our disassembly by removing the currently installed 2.5-inch SSD. After disconnecting it, we can also remove the custom SATA cable by lifting that white part of the connector. This allows us to unscrew and remove the bracket that was holding that drive. As I mentioned, under here we can find an M.2 slot for storage and another one which is currently having a Wi-Fi card installed. After removing its connector, the fan comes out easily as well, after which we can remove the three screws that hold the heatsink on its place. As you can see, it's also taking heat for more than just the CPU. After getting rid of that crusty thermal paste, I'll also get the CPU out of the socket. We have a Core i5-6500T installed. I did come across this exact CPU in similar machines a few times before, so I'm curious to see how well it will perform here. As I did mention then as well, this is the T variant of the i5-6500. So it does perform less fast, but it also consumes quite a bit lower power. As a result, this machine is also very quiet. I could hardly notice it making any noise, even under heavy load. I'll remove that single DDR4 memory DIMM next. As you can see, currently 8GB is installed. Then we can disconnect the tiny antenna connectors from the Wi-Fi card and remove the small screw holding it in place, followed by removing the card itself. Here in front, we also have a small speaker, which we still need to disconnect as well. Finally, this allows us to unscrew the motherboard from the case. As you can see, it's held in place with four screws in each corner. After these got out, we can take the board out of there. Let us take a good look at it. Here we can see the CPU socket, two DDR4 memory slots, CPU fan connector, front connectors, speaker connector and thermal sensor, M.2 slot for storage, M.2 slot for Wi-Fi, CMOS battery, password reset jumper, CMOS reset button, and finally the expansion board with an extra display port and the SATA connector. Before putting everything back together, a small overview of the components that we have here. First, the motherboard, the i5-6500T CPU, original and additional memory DIMMs, SATA SSD, NVMe SSD, the Wi-Fi card, SATA connector, heatsink, and the fan. Let's start our reassembly now by putting the board back to where it came from. Do not forget, I'll also reconnect the speaker right away. Now that the board is firmly in place, we can fix it again as well. While there is still some room here, let me start by putting back that M.2 Wi-Fi card. We need to insert the card in the M.2 slot, fix it, and then reconnect those tiny antenna cables. This is not really my favorite part, and also apologies for not getting this properly on camera. But in general, I try to position the connector properly and then push it down using a tiny screwdriver. Up to the memory now. I'll add another 4GB to the originally installed 8GB, resulting in a total of 12GB. After that, we can open the CPU socket, make sure orientation is correct, and then close it again with the CPU inside. Next up is the M.2 SSD. Similar as with the Wi-Fi card, we just need to insert it and then fix it with a tiny screw. Most of the things are back in place already. I will now first apply some much needed fresh thermal paste, and then we can reinstall the heatsink. The fan has a pretty small connector as well, but once it is in, we can place it back easily as well. The last component to go in is that regular 2.5-inch SATA drive. I'll first need to reconnect that SATA ribbon cable by opening the connector and then carefully pushing it in and close it. Let me fix the bracket back where it was. And once that is done, we can reinstall the original SATA SSD as well and get it connected. There we go. Time to close up the case again and we can move to the testing part. Or at least that's what I thought. As soon as I powered on the PC again, I got to see the following. We can clearly hear 3 beeps with the red LED light, followed by 2 more and a white light. Looking at the maintenance guide, this means there is an issue with memory initialization. So I opened up the case again and tested the memory DIMMs separately. Each of them was working fine on their own, And eventually, after I just removed and reinstalled both of the memory modules, everything seemed to work expected as well. Probably there was a bit of a dust in between the contacts, or I didn't insert one of the modules properly, but the most important thing is that everything is working now. With a bit of delay, we can continue now. Let's take a look at the BIOS first. By pressing F10 on boot, we can get there. We do get a message about the changed memory size, which is completely as expected. And once we are in the BIOS setup, when going to system information, we can see that the CPU and the total amount of memory is properly detected. In advanced boot options, we can see the SATA SSD and NVMe drive as well. I'll change the boot order so the system will boot first from USB, then NVMe, and finally from the SATA drive. As our new NVMe SSD is empty, I'll need to insert the USB drive containing the Windows 11 installer. After saving the changes in the BIOS setup, the system, as I instructed, boots that Windows installer now from USB. Let me fast forward through the installation, as there is nothing special about it. There is no need to perform any workarounds, as this hardware is fully supported for Windows 11. Once the installation is completed, I'll also install all standard and optional updates. And as we could see as well in my last video, this includes BIOS and firmware updates as well. There we go. Finally, after a really long wait, we get to the freshly installed Windows 11, which is fully up to date now. Let's start by taking a look at about this PC now. Here as well, we can see the same information as we could see in the BIOS. In Task Manager, we can see the rest of the hardware, and everything looks as expected as well. Time for our first benchmark, Geekbench 5. As a result, we're getting 824 for single core and 2580 for multi-core. Comparing this with previous results, we can see that the same CPU on a different machine, an Optiplex 7040, scored a little higher, but then again, it comes close to that recently tested 7th generation 7500T as well. All in all, I think this is within the error range of the test, so it kind of performs as expected. Let's repeat the same test now with Geekbench 6 as well. Here we're getting 1099 for single core and 2813 for multi-core. And again, that same CPU in the Optiplex 7040 seems to slightly perform better. Not sure why that is the case. Let's move to AGA system test now. We'll use it to test the performance of the NVMe drive first. (2244 MB/s write and 1929 MB/s read. Very decent performance for sure. I used the same type of M.2 drive on the previous video I did. There, we got 2211 and 1946 MB/s. So, a very similar result as we get here. Let me also test the same on the original 2.5-inch SATA drive, which we still have installed. On that drive, we seem to get around 445 MB/s write and 499 MB/s read speeds. Definitely not bad, but about 5 times slower than the NVMe drive, which is completely as expected. Now let's also check how that Wi-Fi is performing. As you can see, we are connected to an access point using 802.11ac, which is the maximum that the adapter supports. So let's copy a large file over the network and see how fast that goes. We see speeds of around 30 MB/s or around 230 Mbps. With a few drops sometimes, it is a realistic speed to get. And just for fun, let's repeat the same test using the gigabit Ethernet connection as well. As expected here, we're getting about the maximum speed consistently, and the file is being copied at around 112 to 113 MB/s. Very close to 1 gigabit per second, exactly what we want to see. That was all I have for the video. This machine, despite its size and age, is still pretty nice to work with. Performance is not the worst, and as you could see, there are quite some options for expansion and upgrades as well. On top of that, it boots into Windows pretty fast, and it was pretty much silent through the whole time that I was working with it. Thank you for watching. If you have any questions or remarks, or you have a machine like this, always welcome in the comments. If you have liked this video, I'd appreciate a thumbs up. And if you're interested in more of the same, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel and enable notifications. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.